What instrument were you?
I was the catheter. I left Twitch on. I was listening to myself sounding like Homsar.
Look, you've been set below.
Hey, what have you done, you monster?
You are too authentic. That was very...
Is he looking at you or at the door?
The door, actually.
Oh.
Oh, pizza?
Maybe.
Yes.
Right.
Six-string catheter.
Herbie, you're closest to the door.
I'll go pee.
Oh, thank you. Hi, welcome. We're going to play the six-string catheter for you. Today's catheter mystery is a good one.
A pizza.
Oh, good. Would you get it for me?
Sure.
It should be paid for.
Polo, come here.
Goodbye, Polo.
Thank you.
No, that's all right.
Is it you?
What?
Are you? He said there's another guy I used to order from here all the time.
Yes.
Hi.
Hello.
Pizza.
Thank you so much.
Today's mystery is brought to you in part by
Papa John's.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah.
That's a large man.
Thanks, Papa John's, for always tweeting coupon codes at me on Twitter.com. It's how I eat.
Nope.
Basically all the time. Does anyone want a piece of pizza?
I'm okay.
No, thank you.
Polo would like one.
I remember when I tweeted about not having any friends and Papa John's tweeted me a coupon and said, that's okay, you can party by yourself.
Oh my god, that's the best. I love the internet.
Maybe I should get on Twitter after that.
Absolutely. Today's stream is also brought to you by Kashish. Hello, how's it going? Did I say it right? Kashish? It's so weird when you go to say someone's online handle for the first time and realize you've never actually done the mental exercise of figuring out how to say it.
Mm-hmm.
And hi, hello. We happen to receive a cardioid lavalier microphone. Thank you so much for your donation to the stream. I sincerely appreciate it. I don't have the... Obviously, it's in a box, and it, I don't have it set up for tonight, but I will have it set up for next Tuesday, and it'll be of great use. You'll be able to hear my sweet, sweet caramelotones so much better. What?
I can't
You're just so smiley. I just... Oh, my goodness. Cassius? Cassius works. That's good. That's a name of some note from history. I don't know. Why didn't the music keep playing?
Polo scared it off.
Polo, you scared away the music.
Pizza guy.
Pizza. I'm so happy that I have pizza and that we're gathered here to play video games.
Thank God.
We're going to play Towerfall.
Yeah.
These are all the towers that we're going to be in. I'll be the archer.
I knocked them all down.
Good game.
Be careful, one of those towers is really, really scary.
Oh my goodness. You're talking, of course, about the one where all the missing lions have taken up.
Oh, damn it.
As they
with machine guns.
As they wait for the return of the moon.
Oh my goodness. Thank you once again for convening here, 221B Baker Street, after such a long hiatus. We were just here in real life last week, but how long has passed since our last escapade?
13 months, almost.
13 months! It is now April of 1890. As
I can't
we...
believe there hasn't been any crime in 13 months.
I can't believe...
Not crime anyway.
No, it's just been run-of-the-mill crime. But maybe after more than a year, someone has finally noticed that the moon is missing from the sky.
I doubt it.
Probably not. I mean, it just left like a big black hole just sitting right there where the
all
moon
the
used to be.
No one's seen the moon in like decades anyway. I'm not even sure they remember they had one.
We'll find out today as we investigate the mystery of the banker's Quietus. Does anyone know what a Quietus is?
I assume it's pink.
It was the name of a song on the 999 soundtrack, but I don't know anything else. It was a creepy song.
Opposite of a loudus.
Yes, it's the opposite of the loudus. Thank you, Lobos. Case 7.
Wait, you're not going to tell us what it is?
It was the opposite of a loudus. I think those are Final Fantasy spells. The world's first consulting detective, Sherlock Holmes, turns from the fire where he has restored some measure of warmth to his hands and comes to his seat before his morning breakfast. Sitting with us around the table are Inspector Lestrade and Dr. Watson. Well, Lestrade, what brings you to our humble abode on this cold, windy morning? An ill wind, I presume.
You presume correctly, Mr. Holmes. Murder.
Ah, indeed. Who is the victim, and what are the details?
The victim was one Oswald Mason, chief accountant for the Bank of England. He was found murdered at his home at 10 o'clock last evening by his wife upon her return from an evening out. He seems to have been a simple, hard-working man, leading a quiet and unassuming life, and on the surface, there seems to be no motive for the murder.
Well, Lestrade, I don't think you came out on a morning like this just to tell me that you have a murder with no motive. I can't believe that Scotland Yard has exhausted all its resources and must now turn to me. Lestrade does not immediately respond. He keeps his dark eyes focused on the plate of kippers in the center of the table. After a moment, he raises his eyes and looks at Holmes.
You're right, Mr. Holmes. I think it's premature, but I am here at the request of the Exchequer. It seems that Mr. Mason was doing some work for the Treasury, and the Chancellor wants to make sure that Mason's death has nothing to do with the work that he was involved in.
Do you have any evidence that the murder was related to the Treasury matter?
No, none whatsoever. I tried to convince the Chancellor that unless some new evidence turns up, it looks as if Mason's death is just another commonplace murder that I am sure the Yard can solve.
I am sure, Lestrade, but as I have said before and depend on it, there is nothing so unnatural as the commonplace. Right at the moment, I am finishing up a vexatious puzzle, so maybe my friends here will be able to look into the matter until I am free.
Brendan actually discovered there is actually an article in the newspaper about this very murder.
Oh, really?
Let's hear it.
Do tell.
Do you want to? Oh, you did find it.
You do that. I'm going to eat a piece of Bob John's.
That description didn't say...
Excuse me?
The description didn't say how he was murdered, did it?
It didn't, no.
The article does.
Yes. It says here that there was a murder in Bloomsbury. A murder was committed in Bloomsbury last night.
Oh.
Shortly after 10 p.m., Constable Lane, summoned by cries for help, entered the home at 42 Tottenham Court of Mr. Oswald Mason, chief accountant of the Bank of England. This is all one sentence. I'm bad at grammar. And so Constable Lane, summoned by cries for help, entered the home at blah, 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 and found the body of Oswald Mason sprawled across the desk in his study, where he'd apparently been murdered by a blow to the head. Mr. Mason's body was discovered by his wife upon her return to the home at around 10 p.m. The police report only that the intruder apparently entered by an upstairs window, and, judging by the disarray of the study, a struggle occurred in which Mr. Mason met his death. As of this time, the crime has not been... brought home to any person, but the best detectives of Scotland Yard are now involved in the investigation and search for the perpetrator of this bloody crime. Mr. Mason is survived by his wife, Rose, and a brother, Cecil. Or is it Cecil, because we're in England?
Never sure. Rose and Cecil?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I have a friend whose name is Cecil, and he has the darndest time getting him to realize that at Starbucks.
Is
they give him all kinds of misspellings.
C-E-C-I-L?
Yes.
The moon!
I found it.
Sorry, what was the thing about the treasury again in the first part?
So apparently he was doing some kind of work for the treasury.
Okay, so they were
he didn't specify what it was.
That's why I couldn't remember. Cool. Alright.
And he was like the head accountant for the Bank of London? Is that what they said?
That is correct.
Okay.
Chief accountant for the Bank of England.
Chief accountant for the Bank of England.
Well.
Got a few places we could go.
Yes.
Scene of the crime.
Constable Lane, since he was on the scene.
I don't know if there's a Bank of England. I don't know if there's a way that we can contact the Chancellor, or...
That'd probably be at the Treasury, I think.
Yeah, is that...
I
where is that?
Yeah, well, they're probably not going to want to tell us whatever their secret is directly, but...
Difficult to say. I think that the scene of the crime is always...
Yeah, Mason Oswald is at 42 WC.
Fantastic.
42 WC, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it certainly makes sense to check that out.
Take it away.
Ooh. We'll do 42 WC.
You solve crimes.
I'm going to need a piece of pizza from Papa.
Don't choke and create another mystery.
That would be
terrible.
That would
be very mysterious.
Alright. Here we go.
Need help solving this mystery? Here's a coupon for 20% off.
Your next mystery.
The mystery of how to get pizza. Alright. Constable Parks, on duty at the Mason House, shows us the study, the scene of the crime. We find the study in shambles. The office chair has fallen back and all elements which were on the desk are scattered on the ground. The inkwell has spilled its contents on the carpet and the stain is extended to a book which was apparently on the desk. The knickknacks from the commode have also been knocked over, but the furniture from the back of the room is intact. At the foot of the window, we also find the fragments of a completely destroyed plaster statuette. Wiggins is near the window, a magnifying glass in hand, examining the windowsill. There's a palm print right here on the windowsill. Looks like it was left in a residue of plaster dust, says Wiggins as he replaces his magnifying glass in his coat pocket. Where was the body found, Parks? Sprawled across the desk. You can see the blood stain on the top. The blighter put up quite a fight, I must say. How was he killed? Head was bashed in by a statue. He was sent over to the lab for old Murray to look at. Is there any indication of how the murderer got into the house? Looks as if he entered by the upstairs window. It was found open and showed signs of forced entry. Who found the body? His wife. She said she was at her weekly whist game at... Whist game? Must be some card game I haven't heard.
It is.
Ah, cool. At the West End Social Club. She arrived home around 10 o'clock and found her husband dead. Did she see anyone in or around the house? She said she saw and heard nothing. Is the room how she found it? Yep. She said that as soon as she saw her husband lying sprawled across the desk, she ran outside for help. Constable Lane came at the sound of her cries and took charge. The only things removed were the body, which was taken to Bart's, and some of Mr. Mason's papers, which were taken to Scotland Yard. Oh, yes, and the statue, which was sent to the criminology lab. And where is Miss Mason? She was in a state of shock and was taken to her sister, Miss Edward Farmer. Lots of stuff there.
Yes,
yeah.
Oh, what was the last line?
She was in a state of shock and was taken to her sister, Mrs. Edward Farmer. Well.
So.
I also like to say, there are a lot of people dying today.
Well, with the economy.
Yeah, the whole re-exit thing is really messing things up.
No, gosh.
Just on, like, on top of
that. Oh, anarchist. I thought this said Antichrist found dead. I was like, well, that's a load off my mind.
there's that. Four men were drowned.
Wow.
At the same time?
Apparently.
Who has that many arms?
They drowned
octopi.
Drowned?
They're boat capsized.
I see.
By octopi.
So, what lead do we want to follow?
I'd kind of like to talk to the wife, actually. Although I think following up with the criminologist and perhaps the coroner might be also good ideas.
That's what it seemed like.
Alright, so who will find us Mrs. Edward Farmer?
I'll do it.
To clarify, did make it sound like Oswald, I guess, was like writing a book or something when he got attacked? They said ink.
There
was an inkwell for sure. There were papers on the desk and there was a book on the desk. It never connected them any more than that.
I thought it said there was a trail of ink from
the book. Yeah, there was a trail of ink along the floor that led quite a ways.
Actually, I'm interested in discovering whether or not the state of the room and the wife's accounting
match up with, yeah.
Something Farmer? Is that correct?
Edward Farmer. Mrs. Edward Farmer.
33 WC.
Also, there's a criminal court case
here. On trial. Crime. Held accountable at long last.
Oh, man.
Finally, we'll prove that it doesn't
The prosecutrix. This means that was plaintiff in the case, but it sounds rad.
It's so good.
Key tricks. It's awesome.
Mrs. Rose Mason, her face pale against the black of her morning dress, joins us in the parlor. She is a handsome woman in her late 30s. We offer our condolences before asking the deceased accountant's wife to tell us just what she remembers of the previous evening's events.
I went to the West End Social Club for my weekly whist game, as I do every Thursday night. I left Oswald alone at home working on the papers he had brought there from the office. He's been so busy lately that he has had time for very little other than work. When I returned home about 10 o'clock, I went immediately to the study. Mrs. Mason almost loses her composure, but continues stoically. The place was such a mess. Books were strewn about, furniture overturned, and there in the midst of the wreckage was poor Oswald. I can't think of who would want to hurt him. He was the dearest man on earth. Only last week he gave me a Venus de Milo replica to commemorate our 17th wedding anniversary. We spent our honeymoon in Paris, and we often went to the Louvre to see the original. When I saw the statue broken into pieces... We're sorry to trouble you at this time. We know it's hard on you, but we have one or two more questions. Was your husband expecting any visitors last night? No, in fact, he was looking forward to being alone. He said he only had a few hours work left and that he could do the report for the treasury at the bank the next day. Cecil, his brother, was to give us an anniversary party on Friday, and he... Mrs. Mason is unable to continue. Tearfully, she leaves the room on the arm of her sister. Her sister? Okay.
Okay. Well, we can identify the statue, I guess.
Well, I didn't see any gaping flaws in her testimony, necessarily. Perhaps following up with the coroner or the criminologist would be a good idea.
Mm-hmm. That would sound good to me. Which one would you like to take?
Well, we've got a lead on the statue. Why not follow that up? That's Murray, right?
Yep, that is at 22 Southwest. I will say, too, if I was going to give an alibi that would pop almost instantly if it investigated would be a pretty bad one. In the West End Social Club, if she was playing games with a bunch of other ladies.
Right.
That's weird. Rose wasn't here last night, and now her husband's
Well, dead. Remember, octopi have 9 brains, which means they're excellent at coming up with alibis.
All right, we find Dr. H.R. Murray in his laboratory, as usual, his white hair wisping wildly about his face. I think I get this guy every time. What case are you young sleuths working on today? The Oswald Mason murder. Do you have anything to help us? Mason, looks like your Mr. Mason was killed by the man with the broken nose, in quotes.
What?
The man with the broken nose? You mean you know who the murderer is? No, no, not the murderer, the murder weapon. With this, old Murray picks up a marble statue with a cracked head, more obvious than a broken nose. This is a copy of a very early Rodin, The Man with the Broken Nose, sculpted in 1864. Oh. You can see the blood stain here. I understand that this was one of 2 statues on the fireplace mantle. Apparently the intruder grabbed this one and killed Mason in the struggle. Not much else I can tell you. Well, thanks anyway.
So there were two statues.
So did he steal?
There.
Indeed. I wonder if maybe there was something more to this statue than the wife knew about.
Yeah, I mean, if it was just a replica, it wouldn't be particularly valuable not to go to this much trouble to kill someone over.
Maybe something inside the statue? Maybe. Like on another smaller statue
small
of the moon!
I heard about those.
Yes, there's several moons in our galaxy.
Indeed.
I'd like to go to the treasury or maybe to talk to his brother.
I think that's a wise idea.
Treasury would be neat. We've never been there.
Just so. Actually, Mycroft may finally be a relevant lead this time around as a representative of the government.
Definitely.
The Treasury, meanwhile, is at... I'll just start reading every entry in order until we find the one that's relevant. Treasury, 12 Southwest. Shall we go there or talk to Mycroft? Treasury might be a good first one.
Treasury.
12 Southwest.
Stop peeking.
My goodness.
That was it?
No. I'm just astounded by the cavalcade of information I'm about to impart.
Awesome.
Better make sure I don't adopt any... taxing accents for this one. It's going to be a long haul. All
right.
We start off with a mouthful. Sir Adrian Malmquist, KG, CB, which are types of orders bestowed by the Crown, I believe. Undersecretary to the Chancellor of the Exchequer, which is the Treasury, enters the conference room where we have been kept waiting for the last 20 minutes. He is as imposing in person as he is portrayed to be by the newspapers. 39, he is one of the youngest members of the present government. He is tall, aristocratic in bearing, and moves and talks with great energy. Sorry to keep you waiting, but my meeting with the Chancellor ran longer than expected. Throws my whole day's schedule off. This won't take long, will it? Well, the Chancellor asked me to give you all the help I could, interrupts Sir Adrian as he paces up and down the room. I only met the fellow 4 or 5 times. Capable fellow, very capable. Damned inconvenient, this murder. Damned inconvenient. Mason was to have a report for me dealing with some embarrassing regularities. So far, the loyal opposition hasn't gotten wind of the affair, and it is important that they don't until we have cleared it up and have apprehended the culprit. I assured the Chancellor that the matter would be concluded this week. Bloody inconvenient. Could we, we have to get someone to replace Mason. Do you have any idea who murdered Mason? Has it anything to do with his work here? Please, Sir Adrian. If you would just answer a few questions, we may be able to throw some light on the matter. First, do you feel that Mason's death might have anything to do with his work at the Treasury? I wish I could answer that. I never expected it. There is no question the investigation dealt with large sums of money, but murder, it just doesn't fit. It won't stop the investigation, just delay it. The papers that Mason was working on are all accounted for, but again, we had copies of all the important papers in our files, so taking them would not have stopped the investigation or saved the culprit. That brings us to the next question. Do you have any suspicions as to who the guilty party might be? No, I do not. You must understand, the investigation has to come from the outside. The findings must be above reproach, with no question of political advantage. Therefore, I have stayed out of the investigation. All I can do is give you what facts I have. That would be a good start. For the first time since he entered the room, Sir Adrian sits and faces us across the conference table. Here are the facts. As you know, the Exchequer is responsible for all financial business. I should say the financial well-being of the Empire. This year, we were responsible for the distribution of some £600 million, a large sum to keep check of, but we must. 6 months ago, it came to the government's attention that Bacon and Company, one of London's largest investment houses, was in financial straits. Their difficulties had arisen because of their extreme commitments in South America, where political unrest, commercial instability, and the often irresponsible financial policies of various republics have made any sort of investment highly speculative. The firm is solvent, but it is not in possession of sufficient liquid assets to meet its current liabilities. South American politics feature largely in the story. Bacon's dealings with foreign governments, the National Bank of Uruguay, the Buenos Aires Railways, and several other enterprises. Very early on, when the storm was brewing and it was known in the innermost city circles that Bacon's position was insecure, the governor of the Bank of England, Lionel Foxcroft, had inquired of the Chancellor whether the Argentine government might not be persuaded to deal in some way or another with the enormous bulk of discredited South American securities then weighing down the London stock market. The interest rates have been at 5% since the first of the year. If the market had to assume Bacon's losses, the interest rate might rise to 6% or even higher. Well, you know what that means. No.
Yes.
Not really. Can you... That's what I'm trying to do, says Malmquist, as he squirms impatiently in his chair. To make a long story short, Her Majesty's government and the Bank of England have guaranteed to cover the discredited securities by the Bacon and Company and their investors. An audit of Bacon's books showed short-term liabilities totaling to £3,250,000, a reasonable price to pay for long-term stabilization of the economy. Sounds good to us. We'd nod in agreement with Wiggins' concession. Yes, except for one problem. So far, we have redeemed £4,570,000 worth of securities. If the opposition finds out, we could end up being the opposition next year. We'll save their bacon, but damned if they'll profit by it. Ah, goodness. Malmquist pushes back his chair, removes a gold watch from his pocket, and opens it. Well, that's all the time I have. Any help you can give us will be greatly appreciated. Good day. What are we looking for? £1,320,000. What else? The difference between what the audit showed on Bacon's books and the securities that have been redeemed. Where did those securities come from? Damn it, that's what Mason was trying to tell me. Sir Adrian bolts out of his chair. Bloody inconvenient. I certainly hope Holmes will apply his considerable talents to the matter. I am sure Mr. Holmes will be interested in this matter if it will show some light on Mr. Mason's death. Yes, of course, we're all very concerned with solving Mason's murder. If we can solve the murder and clear up this matter at the same time, so much the better. Good day.
Okay.
Indeed.
Yeah, that was a lot.
It was.
Was a lot. I don't know.
I haven't found anything yet going through the paper to try to find any international...
All of that, and I'm actually less convinced about that being a motive.
Me too, as a matter of fact.
Because he's got a point. I mean, the investigation's going to stop. They had copies of everything. I mean, he's calling it bloody inconvenient, not a disaster of any kind. I mean, he doesn't even seem to care too much other than, again, you know, he just told his boss.
So, here is some speculation, but it ties to what we have at present. We have a financial crisis where some money was going to change some hands. We had the Bank of England involved in it. We have a sudden amount of money that appeared and is now missing. And we have a man that was at the center of it who is dead, who has something precious to him that has vanished. It could be that this fellow was at the center of it, had embezzled some funds for himself, and someone that knew about it killed him in order to get the money. Mm-hmm. A possibility.
Definitely possible, but he was from the outside himself, though.
I thought that, and let's double check it, 12 South W, South W. yes. Very early on, when the storm was brewing and it was known in the innermost city circles that Bacon's position was insecure, the governor of the Bank of England, Lionel Foxcroft, had inquired of the chancellor whether the Argentine government, etc., etc. Seems like the bank knew about what was going on and, in fact, initiated some of these proceedings.
That is fair.
It might be worth talking to the people at the bank or maybe even speaking with Foxcroft directly to see if we can find out a little bit more about whether or not Mason was tied into it at that time.
Definitely would go for talking to the bank on that basis.
The Bank of England?
I also feel like this may be a good time to look up. I feel like the back of the... Whoops, this is the wrong book. Wait, this is the right book. Tell us this is the right book. Someone we've never talked to, they may already know all we need to do, but we never... I think we need to talk to the international affairs person before.
Ah, perhaps so. I think that might be a good idea.
Yeah. You want to do that first or the bank?
Also, we have to remember to talk to the gossip columnist. Yes. Turns out the gossip columnist knows a lot about people.
Yes.
Maybe the 17th wedding anniversary.
Well, actually, I mean, she had a spanner in the society. Works. She was in a society club already. He was a fairly high placed member of a bank. So the gossip guy almost certainly would have something on him if there's anything to have.
Yes. Particularly if he's the only person where we can get some information. Let's just go straight down the list and make sure that everyone gets a visit today. Ah, it's been a year and a half since you've come to my tavern. What could I do? What? No, please, leave my establishment.
What's another gear before you come back?
We go to the toy store and Moriarty's contact just like pulls a rat out of his mouth and puts it in our hands.
Sounds about right.
Where should we go?
Bank of England?
Yeah.
I love it.
23 EC.
23?
Oh.
It's you.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's the right book.
23 EC.
Oh. EC. 23
EC.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Mr. Ned Kimball, the chief cashier of the bank, receives us in his office. We find him behind a massive desk, which does his large frame justice, as we reckon his bulk.
Finally, some justice.
As we reckon his bulk to be well over 15 stones in weight. Yes, please, look up the conversion. The silver-haired Kimball greets us affably, although he speaks with gravity. And
15 stones is 12 pounds. The stone, or stone weight, is a English and imperial unit of weight, now equal to 14 pounds. Now we know.
He greets us affably.
He's just made of rocks.
With gravity and a shake of his head at the tragedy of Mason's murder. I just can't imagine why anyone would want to do such a thing. He was certainly well liked by all of his fellow bank workers here at the bank. How long has he been with the Bank of England? He started with us more than 15 years ago. He has always been one of our most trusted and valued employees, and 5 years ago he was enthusiastically approved as a choice for a chief accountant despite his relative youth. As you may know, the bank is controlled by its directors, but they have little to do with the day-to-day operation of business. That is my responsibility. Mason was my second in command. Was he ever involved in any controversy or quarrel over bank business of which you are aware? Well, certainly not. As I said, he was well-liked and did his job superbly. What do you know about his work with the Treasury? Very little. One of his responsibilities is to oversee government audits. That was Oswald's area of civility. His work is highly confidential. You'll have to talk to the governor, Lionel Foxcroft, if you have any questions about this. I'm sorry, that's all I know. Would you object to checking out his office? Oh, no, I suppose that would be acceptable. Although, I thought that Mason's secretary, Miss Mabel Brown, would be the best person to sort through his papers, but she is reported in ill today. Nothing has been done in that regard. Could you give us a list of other members of Mason's staff? Yes, I would be glad to. None of them are here right now, as I gave them the day off. He takes the pen out of his inkwell and begins to write. If I can give you any further assistance, please let me know. With these words, he hands us the following list and shows us the door. Richard Cates, Mason's assistant, Miss Joanna Bailey, head clerk, Mrs. Mabel Brown, Mason's secretary. I don't know how this comma's working. A check of Mason's desk reveals the following items.
Splendid.
He does have a Bacon and Company account from which he has withdrawn £240. That doesn't seem like a lot compared to
those. Not so many.
Yeah. And he did buy two statues at Evanson and Company gifts. That may be worth looking into, because I think these statues are...
Shall we flip it so that stream can see it?
Oh, yes, certainly.
Isn't the Longham one of the hotels in town or something?
The Langham? Yes, I think
it
that's probably...
It looks like a hotel.
Yeah, it looks like a room receipt.
For March the 26th. That's a ways back, isn't it?
When was their anniversary?
No, it's April, right? It's April 1890.
Yeah. Oh, you're right, it's April. Yeah, so how come they're being warming by the fire? Which is weird.
Maybe it's still cold in April.
Yeah, it is.
And then is this an address book or a calendar?
Personal planner, I guess.
Planner,
yeah.
The word I was looking for, thank you.
Greece tickets.
M. Kempfield, Romania, 2 a.m. On the day before he was murdered, or the day he was murdered.
Romano?
Yeah.
We're going to keep reading this word until
it's Ray Romano. Oh, he's the murderer.
Ah!
The man with the broken nose.
Does that something to do with underwater Ray Romano?
What? You're thinking of
Ray. Yeah, he was
planning
to go to Greece in a few weeks.
It seems that way. Probably for their anniversary trip.
When was their anniversary?
I thought they were having a party this Friday or something like that.
His brother was throwing a party, right? Or planning one.
That's pretty cheap replicas. £2, 5 shilling. I think a banker could do a little better if he wanted to.
Yes, indeed.
I definitely think we should look up that gift store, find out if they know any gimmick about the statue.
I think speaking with Foxcroft directly might be a good idea as well.
That too.
Okay. Where should we go?
With the mention of Greece, I kind of like more the idea of the international affairs.
Ah, country. Yes. I think that's also a good idea.
Colonists is still interesting, too. So many choices.
It's true. We'll be playing all night.
Everybody well, loves
Kirby, where would you like to go?
Foxcroft, that was his name, right?
Yes.
That's a good name.
Found a Shadow Moses.
There's a cow house, but it's pretty good.
46 EC.
46 EC.
Yes. I hope he's not dead.
No, he's not dead. Lionel Foxcroft, governor of the Bank of England, stands in front of his window looking into the courtyard. Mm. At our entrance, he turns and addresses us. Please sit down. I understand that you are looking into Oswald's death. I will give you all the help I can. What is it you want to know? Well, the obvious question is who killed Oswald Mason? We asked him that just straight up.
Maybe he knows. It's worth asking everyone. Everyone we meet on the street.
It's just a weird wording to it. I mean, not asking who. Do you have any idea? But
I'm looking for the man that killed my father.
Yes.
Do you know where I can find some sailors?
I wish I knew. It was
He'd
a good
like
man.
To play some lucky hit.
And I can't imagine anyone who would want to murder Oswald. We had great hope for him here at the bank. We understand that Mr. Mason was working on a special assignment at the Treasury. Yes, he was. Could there be any connection between Mason's assignment at the Treasury and his murder? I wouldn't think so. Great sums of money were involved, it's true, but I don't think there's any connection. Very few people knew of Mason's involvement in the investigation. No reason that they should. Who knew?
Okay.
Well, to my knowledge, there were only three people who knew what he was working on for the Treasury. Sir Adrian Malmquist at the Treasury, Richard Cates, Mason's assistant, and myself. Could you tell us what Mason was working on? It's rather complicated, but if you think it will help, I'll try. To understand what is involved, you must understand that the history of the bank, financially, is to all intents and purposes nothing more than a history of the bank rate, and that's what this whole investigation is concerned with. Since the Bank Act of 1844, the interrelationship between the bank and the government has become more intertwined. I am sure you understand the significance of the interest rate on the business of, and thus the well-being of the empire. And the most important factor influencing that bank rate is stability. Mr. Foxcroft, I think that's all we need to know at this time. You've been most informative. Good day.
What was the third person you knew about his work?
Sorry, I fell asleep when I looked
again. It was Richard Cates, Adrian Malmquist, and himself.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Foxcroft. Is that just jalapeno?
Yep.
And cheese?
And pepperoni.
Oh, okay.
Did we
go
see his assistant?
I didn't see pepperoni. I guess underneath the cheese.
His secretary.
I admit they're interesting, and I don't mind talking to them, but I'm definitely getting pretty unconvinced by the treasury angle. As this goes on. I mean, I'm not saying...
Should we investigate the statues?
I want to look at the statues.
Yeah.
Where was that? We may not know yet, right?
There was a picture
of
the store name.
Evanson?
Evanson?
Yeah,
Evanson Co. Gifts.
Evanson and Company Gifts.
Not Evanson and Son.
Yes.
Yeah,
oh, God.
I'm
getting trolled by the game.
That's my big favorite.
That's great, though. I love it.
It's great, but...
It would be better if there was never any errata.
So yeah, if there were no errata, I would have given it a hat tip. But in a game that was as heavily errata as this one, it's kind of like, all right, guys.
You got us. Skulls.
Hello.
The picture didn't say, did it?
Sorry. I didn't mean to summon the skull, but I did.
I'll see if it's in the...
Here's a ghostry.
Yeah, it's in here. Evanson and Company Gifts, 22 Northwest. Yeah! A boo. Oh, no, that's not
Did
boo.
You get these from 22 Northwest?
Yeah, for my wife.
We browse around the shop for a few minutes as Mr. Rodney Dowsher, the shopkeeper, concludes a sale of a small blown glass bird to a young bird-like woman.
What?
When she leaves, we introduce ourselves to Mrs. Dowsher, We are looking into the murder of Mr. Oswald Mason. Among his papers was a receipt from the shop dated March 31st. Can you tell us what he purchased? Oh, yes, here it is. He says as... Oh, wait. Oh, it's Mr. I thought it said Mrs. Oh, yes, here it is, he says as he consults his sales records. He bought 2 Venus de Milo statues. We delivered them for him. Where were they delivered? They were shipped separately, on Mr. Mason's instructions. One to Mrs. Rose Mason on 42, whatever their address, and the other to a Mrs. Mabel Brown of 40 Devonshire.
They were banging.
The statue?
Those banging bankers.
Bankers. That's why the mystery is called the Mystery of the Banging Bankers.
Oh, it all makes sense.
He even did his voice pretty well.
Those statues have certainly proved to be good sellers. I sold the remaining 3 to another gentleman Wednesday. Surely hope that I will be able to get more from the manufacturer. And who might that be?
Yes.
J. Small and Company.
Not J. Small and Son.
There we go.
J. Smallson.
Yeah. Mabel Brown is starting to rise up the aggro list pretty high. She's out sick today.
Right.
When her boss is murdered and she was apparently sent a statue.
They were secret lovers.
And secret murders. Be careful, that's filled with terrible power.
I was about to say, is that the eye of Vecna?
It is.
Great.
You should put it in your eye.
You want to go visit Mabel?
Yeah, let's do it.
Sorry.
No, that's fine.
I keep remembering a thread about some DM put an artifact that was that claimed to be the head of Vecna.
Yes.
We kept wondering why they couldn't cut off their head and put it on correctly.
They got into a huge argument. Yeah. Only for one of them to kill the other for the right to kill their to cut their own head off. At which point, they convinced every one of their still alive friends to do that. And then nothing happened because there is no such thing as the head of Vecna. Anyway, Mabel Brown lives at 40 Northwest. As does Sam Brown.
Good old Sammy Brown.
Maybe the husband did it.
This is a long one.
That's what
all right.
Mabel Brown said.
When she saw her
the
boss
statue.
Naked.
We're met at the door of Mrs. Brown's lodgings by her landlady, Mrs. Quinn. After introducing ourselves, we inquire if Mrs. Brown is in. Yes, she is. Poor dear. I've been worried about her. She hasn't eaten in days, and she didn't go into work today. Has she been with you long? Close to 3 years, ever since she married Sam. It must be hard on her, Sam being gone so much. He's a merchant seaman with Jardines, you know.
Those are those sailors we were looking for.
Oh my god! Finally, my father will rest.
No, we didn't know.
Let's see.
Have you known him long? Oh my, yes. Ever since he was a baby. His mother, God rest her soul, was my dearest friend. Sam has been like a son to me ever since Martha passed away, almost 10 years ago now. Oh, where does the time go? Here we are. This is the door to Mabel's rooms. Mabel, dear, there are some people here to see you about poor Mr. Mason's death.
I'll be right there.
Comes a voice from behind the door. Seconds later, the door is opened by a young woman in her early 20s. She has flowing black hair, which emphasizes the delicate beauty of her ivory complexion.
Mm. Please come in.
If you need anything, dear, just ring, says Mrs. Quinn, who has already started back down the stairs.
How can I help you?
Asks Mabel Brown as we enter the room, and she closes the door behind us. We understand that you've heard of Mr. Mason's death.
Yes, this morning, Joanna, Miss Bailey from the office stopped by and told me the bad news. Ned, Mr. Kimball, gave her the day off and she stopped by to tell me.
How long have you been Mr. Mason's secretary?
3 years, ever since my graduation from Bedford.
Do you know of any reason why anyone would want to murder Mr. Mason?
Oh no! He was such a nice man. He was so considerate.
always remembering everyone's birthday. Last week, he gave me a lovely little statue. At this point, the tears she has been trying to hold back begin to trickle down her cheeks. And last night, it fell off the table and broke as if it were an omen of his death. Joanna woke me this morning and told me of Mr. Mason's death. As we were talking, I turned and saw the broken Venus on the floor, and it struck me as so sad. She breaks into loud sobs. I'm sorry. That's all right. We understand. We are sorry to have to intrude at this time, but we have to check with everyone who might shed some light on this tragedy.
Or some tears.
Delicious tears. I want to help. Please, go on. Do you know of anyone at the bank who might have wished harm on Mr. Mason or anything involving his work that would lead to his murder? No! As I said before, he was very considerate of everyone. He was well-liked. His work was mainly routine and concerned primarily with the operation of bank audits. He has been involved of late with some work for the Treasury, but I know little of that. Mr. Cates might know more, but he often did work for government agencies. No, there's nothing I can think of that would cause such a consequence. Well, thank you for your help. We hope you will soon be feeling better. Thank you. I will ring for Mrs. Quinn to show you out. We meet Mrs. Quinn outside the door and she leads us down the stairs. I hope Mabel isn't in any trouble. No, not at all. Just routine.
She's dead.
She has had so many problems of late. She and Sam always fighting when he is home and then being gone for such long periods of time. A hard life for both of them. I heard her crying last night after she came in. I should have tried to comfort her, but I was already in bed. Life is hard. Well, have a good day.
All right, I want to throw out a little theorizing.
Do it.
So, there was...
Willow wants to hear what it is.
So there was a struggle with Mason.
There was.
Mm-hmm.
This lady doesn't seem like she could have put up much of a struggle.
Quite right.
Her statue was busted.
Yes.
What if someone broke in and broke the statue looking for whatever is in one of these five statues?
Maybe so.
And also broke into Mason's house, but Mason fought back and was eventually killed with an unrelated... Notice that when the wife came in, she said the Venus statue was broken.
Yes.
And there were two statues up, and the police said two statues. So I'm guessing that he, you know, hit him with the statue that was not the mission objective.
Right.
He hit him with the statue of opportunity. And thus, whoever we're looking for is just after what is in one of these five statues.
I like this so far. It's definitely more convincing to me than anything else.
And because she, like, she doesn't seem like she's capable of being the, like, I didn't even think about that until I started putting this together.
Mm-hmm.
But her being the murderer seemed unlikely just because she doesn't seem very physically imposing.
Right.
Because she was able to put up a struggle against someone who eventually beat.
There was a throwdown.
She wouldn't have.
I think it might be worth talking with Jay Small and Company to see if we can get a read on what the deal is with these statues.
I want to know about the statues.
They jumped to the top of my list after that one.
Indeed.
Also ghosts.
Okay. Yeah, I was just confirming. I thought it had read that like she was talking to somebody and then it fell off and she saw it right there.
Well,
but
she noticed it was broken.
She noticed it then, yeah. And it happened during the night.
I don't know where to look for this.
Small and Company.
What are you looking for?
Jay Small & Co. is at 32 Southeast.
32 Southeast.
We make extremely fragile statues for your enjoyment. Would you like to purchase some extremely fragile statues?
Well, they didn't make them, right? They just bought the other three.
Oh, they bought them. Okay, sorry.
On arriving at Jay Small & Company's ceramics factory...
Yeah, they made them.
One of the workers directs us to Aggie Small, who, he informs us, runs the company. She is small and wiry, and moves and speaks with authority. After we introduce ourselves, she invites us into a small office cluttered with statuary, miniature reproductions of the world's great art. We are interested in obtaining some information about the Venus de Milo statues that your company manufactures. I must say, there certainly has been a lot of interest in those statues. Could you fill us in? Wednesday, a nice gentleman, he said his name was Mr. Hawkins, and that he had a shop in Southampton, came to the shop, and was so taken by them that he wanted to buy all that I had. Unfortunately, I only had It says had live. I'm going to assume it's supposed to be five. Had five left in stock, all of which he purchased. He was so impressed by them that he wanted to know where he could find the rest and see if he could buy them back. I told them I was planning to make more, and if he could wait a week or so, he could have all he wanted. He insisted he could not wait, and I gave him the names of the other buyers. Mm-hmm. Could you give us that information? Yes, but there are only two. Five were sent to Evanston and Company, and five more were sent to the gift shop of the British Museum. Have these statues always been so popular? No! My husband made up 15 of them 3 years ago, but refused to sell them. Could we speak to your husband? No, he died a fortnight ago. Oh, we're sorry to hear that. Well, I must say, you're probably the only ones. You and the barman at the Red Boar Inn.
Interesting.
Mr. Hawkins. Yes, indeed.
Yeah, so Hawkins is looking
sorry about this. What was the bar that he frequented?
The Red Boar Inn.
Isn't that the shady place?
It is. It's where we went. It was where...
Mustache man, right?
Ah, yes. Yes. What was the activity that was there? It was some sort of a gaming house or something like that? Or fencing? Or not like rapiers, but like...
Right.
If you wanted to meet a guy that could offload goods for you, you'd meet him there.
Sounds right.
Or something.
I'm nervous about checking Hawkins because it feels like it might have been like a fake name or something for something like for a purpose like this.
Sure. Although.
Yeah, it could. Although I want to find out more about him.
I definitely want to find out more about him. It might be one of those bad leads.
No, you're right. You're
I
right.
like the it idea of going to the Red Boar.
Yeah, that I...
So we have the locations of all of the statues, yeah. Right?
Well, doesn't the Red Boar lead us to what happened to her husband, not to what happened to Hawkins?
That's true.
Well, her
husband had 15 of the statues and refused to sell them, and he died 2 weeks ago, and hey,
never mind, yes, let's go.
Yes. it might also be worth stopping by the British Museum just to find out.
See if they're all there. Yeah.
See if they've had a break-in recently or something like that.
Yeah.
I believe this is yours.
That would be hilarious. Check out someone broke into the British Museum to look if they moved the gift shop.
Do we want to check
a shot?
Are we checking Hawkins?
We're checking the Red Boar Inn, I think. Okay. I think the bartender might have some information for us. Like how to get a drink.
Red Boar Inn, 34 Southeast.
34
Southeast.
I never get it the first time.
East in the beginning? Yes, it is. Ah, 34 Southeast. This seems like it could be...
An auspicious entry.
The barman greets us amiably and becomes appreciatively talkative after we buy him a pint of bitters. Ah, old Johnny. He was a wild one, he was. Always expected him to come to a violent end. What a bloke he was. What can you tell us about him? I could tell you lots of stories, mates. The time he got the two women from the circus and... those are not the stories we're interested in. What can you tell us about his business? His business? Oh, you meant that ceramics or whatever you call it shop? I don't know much about that. He didn't seem to spend much time at it. I think he bought it to satisfy his old lady. Seems like she wanted something respectable. As if anything could have made Johnny respectable. Well, what did he do before he acquired his ceramic shop? Jeez, mates, I don't know. I only met Johnny three years ago when he bought his shop. Now, Ned, down at the end of the bar, he knew Johnny a long time. Used to work for him until the old lady fired him a few days ago. Want me to have him come down and join us? Sure. Hey, Ned! Come on down here. These blokes want to buy you a pint. Ned drains what is left of his drink in front of him and starts down dour into the bar. He is a small man, dressed in well-worn work clothes, which are dirty and patched. By the time he reaches us, a new pint is waiting, and the barman has taken his 4D. 4D plus tip from the money we have left on the bar. I assume that's a denomination.
Yeah.
Gentlemen, this is Ned Blake. Ned, they'd like to know something about Johnny Small. What do you want to know, mates? We understand that you knew Jonathan Small before he bought the ceramic works. Can you tell us anything about him?
I guess I ain't gonna do Johnny no harm now. Yeah, I known him a long time. We growed up together in the East End. He was older than me, and I guess he got used to taking care of me. He used to trail behind those three musketeers, as everybody used to call us. Call Johnny, Leroy Aiken, and Nat Cook. I don't know how he made the money to buy a shop. There were tales about the Drummond's bank robbery and other heists. I don't know for sure about any of this, but I know that Johnny wasn't always on the right side of the law. But he was a good bloke and took care of his mates. He gave me a job when he got the shop, and I held that up until last week when the missus fired me. Why'd she do that? She never did like me or any of Johnny's old friends that he hired to help out. So when he kicked off, she kicked us out. Me and old Leroy Aiken. He was Johnny's best friend, but she don't want no reminders of Johnny around.
There was something in those statues.
Leroy.
Best buddy would be the most likely to know about it.
I think that's fair.
E-A-K-I-N.
Oh, E-I-K-I-N?
E-A.
E-A. It's in the game.
Leroy Aikens.
Interesting. We do have a possible source of... Well... So is a bank. Oh, maybe that's the missing funds.
Was maybe.
The bank robbery, if they were never found out.
Maybe so.
But he had these made up a long time ago, didn't he?
What was made up a long time ago?
The statues?
They were, I thought.
He had them for a while. I don't think it's specified how long.
But he didn't want to sell them.
He didn't want to sell them. That was definitely a thing.
So he could.
I thought he said that they did make them a while ago. We could double check it.
Yeah, what was that? What was the factory again?
That's 32 right. Southeast.
32 Southeast.
Intriguing everything.
Okay, I'll find Southeast. Yep, 32 Southeast. You made them up 3 years ago.
How did things happen 3 years ago?
We should look and see what happened in 3 years
ago. Absolutely do that.
They don't go back 3 years. Unfortunately, they go back 2 years.
Unfortunate.
Mostly well, made the statues. Yeah, not really.
Well, if we're interested in having chicken, Leroy Eakin is at 20 Southeast.
20 Southeast?
Yep.
I would like chicken.
Alright. Here we go. Yeah, I knew John Small, answers Leroy Aiken in quick question. Leroy is a small man with the muscular build of a laborer. I don't see how that has anything to do with you. We would just like to ask you a few questions. We are trying to ascertain if there might be some connection between Mr. Small and a murder that took place last night. Boy, I'll tell you. Poor Johnny. Here he is dead a fortnight being accused of a murder from the grave. When are you all going to leave the poor man alone? You people hounded him all his life, and now you won't let him rest in peace. You don't understand. We're not trying to implicate Mr. Small. It's just that our investigation has led us to Jay Small and Company, and we are trying to gather information to see how it fits into our investigation. Then it may be Johnny's old lady that's involved. Jeez, I'd do anything to get that bloody old bat. I still think she has something to do with Johnny's death. Oh, we were under the impression that Small died under natural circumstances. Yeah, well, that's what Aggie would like everyone to believe, but I don't. I went to St. Thomas Hospital and tried to talk to the doctors, but they wouldn't talk to me. Said there was no reason to suspect foul play. Well, I'll tell you what... Oh, jeez. I'll tell you what's foul. Aggie Small, that's what.
Rude.
Sorry. Is that why she fired you? Because you accused her of having something to do with her husband's death? That's one reason. Her and Johnny didn't get along too well. She blamed a lot of his troubles on his friends. She felt they had led Johnny astray. And had they? Nobody led Johnny anywhere he didn't want to go. Sure, Johnny was wild, and I'm not saying he didn't break the law now and then, but growing up in the East End don't give you much respect for the law. Do you know of any crimes Mr. Small might have been involved in? Hey, look, I told you, I'm not interested in talking about the rumors in Johnny's past. I can see you're only interested in the lies about Johnny. I've said enough, now get out. Can you tell us how to No! The door slams in our face.
So, Jonathan Small was killed on the 30th of March, of injuries received in a hit-and-run carriage accident.
Oh.
That's not natural causes.
Well, sure. I mean, horses occur in nature all over the place.
Carriages,
deserts,
too.
Forests.
Just in pieces,
yeah.
Unmanufactured.
From carriage trees.
Interesting.
Might be the stables would be a source of information if there was a carriage involved.
Indeed.
Yeah, although I do wonder if we're wandering too far off the beaten path of actually solving...
I don't know. It's interesting, though.
It is interesting. That is true.
Yes.
It reminds me of one of those other ones where we discovered afterwards that there were like massively deep, completely unrelated things going on.
That's fair. Yeah. That's fair.
But again,
I think digging at this makes sense, but yes. I think we need to find a connection.
Yes. So Mrs. Small may have murdered Johnny, not knowing about the statues, because after she died, she sold them. Who would have gone looking for the statues? His associates?
Yeah, Nat Cook would be the next person I'd want to try and look up.
Who was that? I'm sorry?
That was his other close associate, the Three Musketeers, him and this guy.
We got to talk to him.
Nat Cook.
Okay.
All right, Leroy Aiken.
I'm open to suggestion. Where should we go?
Cook? See if we can find Cook?
Sure.
Yeah, we were trying to ask him where to find him, and the door got slammed in our face.
COOK?
Hmm? I assume.
There may be an E at the end.
Could be.
Ah, like in British times. There is a T. Failor Cook. There's also Cook's Billiard Room.
Mm. Where did we find it? A Red Warren is where we found it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Let's see how that was spelled. Mm.
Yeah, maybe it's like something totally unrelated, because yeah, I'm starting to realize I can't read and talk well.
You did a fine job.
Or I guess I feel like it's slower than I think it should be in my head.
No, it's COOK.
I think we may need to just pick one of these and try it. Perhaps a billiard room for a man of vices.
Oh yeah,
that would... 8 Southwest.
Oh. There's writing here. We enter the hall of the Diogenes Club and are met by a doorman.
Wait, what?
Oh.
8 Southwest?
Yes.
Maybe the billiard room is connected.
Maybe so. The Diogenes Club is where Mycroft hangs out.
Oh. Huh. Wait, really?
Yeah.
Yeah, it is. 8 Southwest, yeah. Well, we're getting one or the other because we want to go see him anyway.
Proceed.
Okay. The doorman shows us into the stranger's room where he bids us wait while he informs Mr. Mycroft of our presence.
So the Diogenes Club is a club founded by noblemen who hate interacting with other people, named for the Greek philosopher who hated interacting with other people. The Diogenes Club has one very, very strict rule, which is when you're at the Diogenes Club, you're not allowed to talk out loud at all to anyone. And if you do, you are given a stern look. If you do it twice, you're rejected. The Strangers Club is where you're allowed to receive visitors. It's part of why I love Mycroft so much. He founded a club where you're not allowed to talk to anyone.
That sounds beautiful.
Yeah.
Wiggins, how are you? Says Mycroft as he maneuvers his large frame through the door. I see you have your friends with you. Please be seated, all of you. Thank you, Mr. Holmes. We are assisting your brother in investigating the death of Oswald Mason. Since I audit the books for various government offices, I was sure Sherlock would want to talk to me about it. Did you know Mason? We had worked together on a number of projects over the years. A good man with a good mind. Did you work with him on the treasury project he was engaged in at the time of his death? I had talked with him from time to time, but I had no official part in the investigation. Due to the political sensitivity of the situation, the Chancellor wanted an outside audit so there would be no question of withheld information. Do you think Mason's murder was connected with the audit? No, I am sure there was no connection. In the first place, there are only a few people who knew what Mason was working on. In the second, it would have accomplished nothing. We know who was responsible for the embezzlement. The only thing that had to be determined was how deep the damage went and what has to be done. Who is the embezzler? Michael Essex and Mitchell York, the directors of Bacon & Co.
Hmm. That makes sense.
Well, that's not what I thought we were getting into.
It's not, but it is valuable information.
Yeah, I'd also like to point out Something I've noticed is that I have a tendency in a lot of these things to second guess what people, like people's assessments of people and such like that, because it's a mystery and
sure.
I've kind of looked for, but I think it may be worth taking some more things at face value, at least as a like direction for thinking. Namely, everyone's saying pretty great stuff about
Mason himself.
Yeah, like his character seems like unbesmirchable. It seems very unlikely that he's engaged in any double dealing intentionally.
Yeah.
And secondly, everyone's saying this is not related.
That's part of why. No.
Which leads me to believe it's actually not related.
Statues fit both of those.
So the statue angle seems like the thing here.
As valuable as that is, I think that is very clearly not where we intended to go. So perhaps we can give ourselves that as a free lead, given that we assumed
that was
accidentally wandered into Mycroft's presence.
Yes.
Okay.
If we want to try the other one, the residence of one T. Phalor Cook, that's at 4WC.
We'll try that one.
Might be his dad or brother or something.
Or an alias.
4WC? Yeah.
4WC.
Yeah, that could just be a nickname.
Yeah. It could be maybe...
nothing there.
Nothing there. Check maybe adjacent, like scan your eyes really quickly, adjacent 8 South W to see if there's a billiard room next to it. Like, I tried to look at the map, but I couldn't find one.
Hmm. Well, if we wanted to know about a criminal past, Forky Shinwell might
have... Quite right.
I still want to check out the museum also.
That's following the trail of the statues.
Yeah, anything specific from evidence always has higher priority with me than the back of the book.
Yeah. At this point, it almost doesn't really matter what's necessarily in the statues. It's what...
Who knew about it.
It's who knew about it and what were they willing to do to get it.
And that cook being hard to find is interesting.
Yes. Museums.
British Museum.
The British Museum... Why is this difficult?
We've been there before.
Yeah. We have.
There was a mummy.
We know exactly where it is in London, as a matter of fact. It's 38WC.
Heck, we've been there for at least two cases, because the French actor supposedly was there too, but he was totally lying.
Ah, just so.
All right. 38WC. Yes, we received a shipment of statues from J. Small and Company. I remember it well, 5 reproductions of the Venus de Milo. As a matter of fact, we sold the last 4 today. All to the same person, a beautiful young lady with long red hair and fair skin, who gave her name as Mrs. Smith. I'm sure I've seen her on the stage, though not under that name, but for the life of me, I can't remember what her name is. Do you know who purchased the other statue? Yes, I do. Mrs. Smith asked the same question. It was purchased by Dame Smedley on April 3rd.
Smedley?
Smedley. Smedley.
What the hell?
Who are these other people?
The introduction of a femme fatale.
She's interested in... Yeah.
I don't know, we've gotten an awful lot of leads.
But she's definitely giving an alias and getting the statue.
It's so.
And interested in this is like, the other one.
This is like when you arrive at a location and like an agent of Smash like pokes their head into the window to let you know that you're on Carmen San Diego's trail.
Oxford Music Hall, Miss Violet Blue sings her heart out in the brightest new songs of the year throughout the month.
Violet Blue?
Yeah, it seems an odd name.
I love her.
With red hair, though.
It's funny, though. Where's that at?
Just as Oxford Music Hall. I don't know the location.
I know where that is. It's in London. No, really, it's... dang it. I thought I did. Music halls. Oxford Music Hall. Oh, that's right.
An attempted burglary at Evanston & Co.'s gift store on Wednesday night. The lock on the back of the door was broken. Nothing appears to have been stolen. The safe in the office shows no sign of force.
Interesting.
Huh. So someone who wants stuff, but who isn't a professional thief themselves.
Well, unless they were just looking for the statues, which they knew wouldn't have been in the safe.
Ah, just yeah. So. You wouldn't have put the statues in there if you were just the gift shop.
If the statues were gone, nothing would have been stolen, because that was literally the only thing they wanted.
Right.
Yep.
Huh.
Interesting.
A lot of people are after this thing.
or just one person very, you know?
With many arms, an octopus!
Ah!
Oh, here's another thing about Miss Violet Blue. On the back of the paper as well, interesting.
What's that say?
Miss Violet Blue was spelled differently this time. Sings her heart out, it's the same thing. I think it's part of the errata. Let's see. Oh wait, there's actually an Irish exhibition. Oh, hold on. Irish exhibition Olympia tomorrow. Madame Leona Dare will ascend, in capital letters, to the clouds from the parade ground in front of the grandstand, suspended by a silk cord from the balloon Olympia.
Hmm. Maybe she bought him because she really just liked him.
Maybe the planet Venus will align in the position where the moon once sat, allowing her to unlock the fifth gate. Accessing ultimate power!
It is a total long shot, but red hair is not unknown in people from Ireland.
That's racist.
I don't see a dare in the...
May I?
Yes, please.
No, I do see a Darby, though.
Well, she might be... There might be, like, an Irish exhibition.
What about Smedley?
Well, she's probably from out of town.
Did it say the order in which the statues were bought? Did Smedley buy one and then the
yes.
woman bought
Yes, because she bought four and asked where the other one was.
That's right. Okay.
Yeah.
Wild statues by statues.
Is there any chance that Smith is her actual name and we can just look in the
back? potentially. Didn't he say that she had a different name?
On stage.
Yeah.
There are seven Smiths.
Haven't we gone to the...
Check all the Smiths.
No.
We haven't figured out where
she's performing. Oh, we haven't found out where she's performing.
Which one?
There's two options, right?
Oh, you were looking at the paper. That's what the name of the place was. The Irish Exhibition.
That's,
I thought we were going to go see...
That's an Irish exhibition. Oh. That's in front of the grandstand.
Ah, okay.
Yeah.
So we don't think it's Violet Blue anymore?
I don't think it would be. That wouldn't make sense.
Violet.
I feel like that's a, if this is the route to go, that would be a clue to be like, not red hair, like, I don't
know.
Yeah, okay. Unless
it's
just wigs, I don't
know. Ink on your hands from the octopus? Sorry.
What was it called?
Grandstand?
Is it inky?
Grandstand? Huh?
Is the octopus inky?
It is.
Yeah.
Don't touch it, it's sticky. I probably just ruined the mat. No, I didn't. Yay!
Why is it inky?
Because I spray painted it. And because it wasn't, that paint doesn't stick well to rubber.
Oh, grandstand. I didn't see it in the front. I'm trying this one again, but I'm not having a lot of
fun. I thought that was an intentional thing. Like, it was like an ink octopus.
Oh, it's so intentional.
I was like, that's way too much
Google.
Attention to detail, Brendan.
Hello.
There's a little man riding him.
It's a lady.
It's
there's
like,
a little lady riding.
She's like a quailag.
It's a quailoctopus.
Oh man. It was tough.
My favorite cereal. Quailoctopus.
Yeah, the grandstand is in here. I'm not seeing it, but that doesn't mean a lot. We've missed things in this thing before.
Hmm.
So we've looked three or four times.
Is this the one? Or?
Yes.
Oops, sorry.
I feel like this is the most open, like,
oh, yes.
Like it feels like we haven't hit any dead ends. We have just hit
upsettingly so.
More.
Can I take a look?
Yes, please.
We have created our.
One thing I didn't get to was looking under T for B.
Ah, perhaps there's something more general, like.
What are we looking for? The exhibition.
Yeah, the grandstand. Although, actually, the grandstand gave her name. I guess we could just look up her name and see if she's in town.
I think he looked. Oh. Didn't you say he looked?
Yeah.
There was a Darby, but...
A dare.
Dare.
Right. Yeah, there are no dares. That sounds like a stage name. If you're, you know, hanging by a silk cord and your name's Dare. Like,
is there anything else of Irish relevance in the paper?
There is, but it didn't look like anything.
Let's hear it.
There was the cowhouse shooting.
Oh my god. You're so racist.
Ireland, Cork,
it said it was in Ireland.
For Reuters.
Oh.
And Innes telegram gives further particulars of the shooting of John Fitzgibbon, the herdsman. That's that whole thing, yeah.
Cowhouse.
Right.
I thought you were slandering the Irish yet again.
Uh,
what about map sellers? They'd know about Ireland.
What is the grand scheme of the room?
Oh, wait. Do you have the paper?
Mm-hmm.
May I? Irish exhibition at the Olympia. The Olympia is a theater.
Oh, because it says later Olympia is a balloon.
Perhaps it's a theater in a balloon.
In a balloon.
Oh, at, in either case, it's at 63 Southwest.
A ballooner.
No, is this me? Did you read this? I remember who read this.
Where, or is...
It was the museum.
Or is it 60-something Southwest?
Never read about
yes.
The balloon over top.
What was the museum?
Is it interactive 3D map?
Oh, it's a balloon. I get it now. Zoinks!
But it only can move when no one's looking
yeah,
at it.
Yeah, that was me.
Right. So 63 Southwest.
It's doing that flickering thing. Thank you.
63
no,
Southwest.
No, quit flickering.
Uh-oh.
63 Southwest.
Trying to autofocus.
It is.
Oh yeah, can you turn the autofocus?
I can!
Bink. But...
She was looking at it.
Oh, yeah,
we should have been saved.
Yeah, no, no, you're right. Oh, no. Pull up.
Sorry about that, friends.
Yes. No, I have been booed.
Soviet Russia. Polo sneaks up on you. Yes, you do, Polo. In Soviet Russia, anyway. But Soviet Russia no longer exists.
Well, oh, wait, it's 1890. It doesn't exist yet.
Yeah.
Oh, yes, yes.
You want me to read while you try that or
yeah.
something?
Well, actually, I've just figured it out.
Oh.
But thank you. Where am I going? 63?
63 Southwest.
63 Southwest.
That is
art. Nothing.
Really?
Nothing.
Is that
blackest
the
and most
place?
Metal clue of all.
The Olympia?
Was that the correct location?
I hope so. 63.
It is worth noting, and Mr. Hawkins is the one who went
oh,
to the factory
there.
To ask about the statues.
Yeah, I forgot about him.
Yeah.
A red-haired woman did it before. Maybe he gave his real name. I mean, we're running out of good options. We can check, you know, checking a likely alias is starting to look better now.
We haven't been to Oxford Music Hall to look on at the other performer, even though they're very clearly blue and violet and not red.
We do have an L. Hawkins in the
only one?
Dictionary.
That makes me much more enthusiastic.
Why don't we try Hawkins?
Yeah, we never checked him.
Who was he again?
You inquired about the statues at the factory.
Hmm. Our knock is answered by a young man with pleasant, albeit unremarkable, features. Mr. Hawkins? Yes, how can I help you? Mr. Hawkins asks with a puzzled look on his face. Did you by chance buy some statues at the Evanston & Company gift store the other day before yesterday? No, I certainly did not. I never even heard of such a store. You must have the wrong person. Sorry to bother you.
All right, our first complete failure.
Well, it's clearly
him.
He did it.
Yeah, it's him.
Yeah, he did it. But yeah, there is another performer we can check out who was mentioned.
At the Oxford Music Hall.
Yeah.
At...
Polo Town.
Polo Town. Well, he's not from Britain.
Oxford Music Hall is
he's from Texas.
13 Northwest.
13 Northwest.
Hello.
13 Northwest. Sounds like you're looking for Violet Blue, responds the doorman. That's her, the poster. Beautiful woman, isn't she? She's not on stage tonight. Wasn't yesterday, either. Do you know why? The manager says she's ill. Sandra Gamble is her stand-in. She's a real beauty herself. You should catch the act. You won't be disappointed.
But they didn't let us see the poster.
She can't just wear a wig,
but
right?
Actually, you know, if her fill-in is actually the red-haired one, it would explain why no one remembers her because she doesn't go up as often.
Maybe so. Violet Blue is actually in the books as Violet Blue at 49 EC.
I like that. Let's go. One day we'll get a real entry for you to read.
I'm kind of glad to have finally gotten some stumpers. 49, is that what I said out loud?
Yep.
Yeah, that's a good point. If these all spiderwebbed out into more clues, where would we even be? The moon, right?
I can't wait to go to the moon. Alfie Kent, the doorman, we have learned so many names today, informs us that Violet Blue does have rooms here, but is not in at present. Bob convinces Alfie to show us Violet's rooms. As we enter Violet Blue's rooms, we are immediately struck by their chaotic disarray. Near the fireplace grate lie the shattered remains of at least 10 Venus de Milos.
Well,
on a nearby table are two wrapped packages bearing the label of the British Museum, which, when opened, reveal another pair of Venus statues. A check of the bedroom shows dresser drawers open and empty. The wardrobe has been stripped of its contents. The remaining three odd shoes and faded housecoat are the only indicators of the departed occupant's feminine gender. If it's Miss Violet you'll be wanting, I might be able to help you out, mates. Another bob to Alfie, and his tongue begins to wag. That's funny, even the toe wag is written T-A-wag. Maybe a typo, but it's charming. Miss Violet left about 20 minutes ago in the company of a young gent. Quite a hurry they was in. I'd say maybe trying to catch a train. I was putting their luggage in a four-wheeler, and I hears the young man tell the cabbie to take him to Waterloo Station. Thanks, Alfie. Much obliged.
Well, I think I know where we're going.
The chase is on!
Do we need any more information?
We don't know what's in the statues.
We've got to find them and kill them.
We don't know who killed him, because it wasn't the woman, probably.
I don't think there's 1.4 million...
To Waterloo!
...pounds in the statue.
37 Southeast.
37 in the Southeast. Southeast is in the front. Oh, that's quick. Constable Parks is standing at the entrance of the station. He recognizes us as we get out of our hansom. You're a little late, mates. You just missed all the excitement. Mr. Holmes and Inspector Lestrade just left with two reluctant companions. A young man and woman they were. What a howl the woman put up. She was sure upset she was. The young man tried to make a run for it, but only got as far as waiting arms of Dr. Watson.
That's it.
That's extraordinary.
We saw the case.
Yeah.
Did we?
Well, we saw the case get solved.
Know who they caught, then. I assume that the man did the killing and was our... Yeah, Hawkins.
Struggle, right? And he came out.
Yeah.
But their identities...
We only know him as Hawkins.
Yeah. Hawkins, that's it.
That's clearly an alias.
We could Okay, go ahead.
No, you go ahead.
It seems like we might want to talk to the criminal element.
Or the...
The cabbies that took them there?
The lawyers who represent the captured people and other ones. I mean, if they...
Oh, you just go out of the police station and ask who they are? That seems like...
I have to assume that none of the other entries that we find are going to be...
Yeah.
Order... are going to be chronologically after what we've just witnessed.
Yeah, that's true.
But by the way, like, that better be a free lead, because Holmes was there.
Right,
If Holmes tries to tell
us... We know he was there. Yeah.
If he tries to pull on us that he didn't check that...
Unless it was a doppelganger.
Interesting.
Maybe Hawkins is Nat Cook.
So,
that's possible.
I said there were two more that she had that weren't broken.
They might have just found
what they were looking for, right?
They broke open the vast majority of them.
Oh, that's true, yeah.
Or they already found it, so they didn't need to open those two.
And they hurried away.
So here's what I think. I think that we have the nuts and bolts of it. I think we could find more information, but it's probably going to be supplementary to what's already going on. So we have to weigh, do we want the extra information, either for points or not, or do we want to solve it?
I feel like, two points on this. One, I feel like we're going to get nailed to the wall if we don't actually know who killed him. That's a pretty serious...
I feel like we could say Hawkins and still count that as correct.
Not knowing his real identity feels shaky. I also say that another time we were in this exact situation and we stopped investigating, we really got nailed to a wall.
That's fair.
He's in custody, so it's not like it's just like some guy that we don't know.
Did it say where they took him?
I don't think it did.
Just that Watson grabbed it.
Yeah.
And Lestrade was there.
Oh, we'll go to Watson's house.
I feel like we'd be tired.
I also feel like we probably would get nailed to the wall if we don't know exactly but what was in the statue. Because actually, I think that was actually the point that we tripped over in a previous one, where we didn't know the thing that was actually being thrown around,
point.
And then by not finding that, we flunked about half the questions.
Yeah.
So we've got two big gaps that are reasonably worth trying to figure out.
Well, I think that figuring out Johnny Small's history and what score he got away with.
Would you guys want to go to St. Thomas Hospital where he was taken when he died? Or when he got
that
hit?
Was specifically mentioned. Doctors wouldn't talk to a member of the rougher class, but they might talk to official investigators.
I'm less concerned with how he died and even necessarily who killed him than what it is that he had that resulted in Mason dying.
Well, the records may not help us with the future past, but they might help us with the past past, because there's not only, Quentin Hogue, the criminal affairs guy, there's,
We haven't been to Porky's yet.
Porky, I think there's a... there's also Disraeli O'Brien compiles old legal and criminal documents.
Might be worth a visit.
Any of the three of them would be reasonable. Any votes for which one?
Just sweep the back.
I think Disraeli might be a good choice.
All right, we'll start with him. 14 WC.
Have we ever been to him?
Nope.
And also, we get to go to a new guy. That's fine.
Yeah.
Okay. Disraeli O'Brien shows us the files and the names we have requested. Nat Cook, convicted of stealing diamonds in 1887, awaiting release from Millibank Prison.
That's
why we can't find where he lived.
Leroy Aiken, convicted of pickpocketry in 1878, served 1 year, arrested in conjunction with armed robbery attempt in 1883, tried and acquitted, cited for public drunkenness and disturbing the peace twice in 1882, once each in 1885 and 1886. Jonathan Small, convicted of selling stolen goods in 1880. Served 6 month prison term, cited on public drunkenness and disturbing the peace in 1885 and 1886, and twice in 1882. Notably, those are the same exact ones the other one was cited for. Suspect in Drummond's bank robbery, 1886, never brought to trial.
Which one of those years coincides with 3 years ago when this, is that when it started?
We're in 1890, so I guess 1886 would be the closest to 3 years.
So with the diamonds in 87?
Diamonds were in 1887.
That'd be 3 years ago?
Yeah. That was 3 years ago, yeah.
So diamonds?
Potentially.
Diamonds
would be a lot easier to best leave. Stash inside statues than paper money.
Yeah.
Yes.
And also, diamonds would survive.
Yes.
Better.
True.
No one would go around smashing statues that they were worried they might rip a piece of paper that was ridiculously valuable.
You're literally making ceramics and you've got a bunch of stolen diamonds. Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. I still don't know who our dude is, though. I mean, it could be the third man, I guess.
Nat Cook.
Well, he's in prison. So
No.
No, you know who?
Richard
Cates.
Cates.
Wait, who's...
That's his assistant to the bank. No, that's not it at all. He didn't know about the statues. I'm sorry.
Yeah, he doesn't know about the statues.
That's crazy.
Could it be...
Satan?
No, could it be...
What?
Could it be Aiken? I mean, we talked to him, but...
It could be.
Well, they said this was they said he was with a young gentleman.
Ah, just so.
Still have the other two on the back of the book who might have information on past criminal dealings. That's Porky Shinwell and Quentin Hogue.
Well, now I'm less concerned about the history of it, and now I'm interested in who would know. Now I'm actually back to who knew Jonathan Small and who knew about that stuff. So maybe now go into the coroner, or not the coroner, St. Bart. Was it St. Bart? St.
Thomas.
They would put him in different spots.
St. Thomas.
Yes, excuse me.
Oh, if he just told somebody, that'd be weird. Oh, whatever. We're going places.
He may have had visitors or something.
Where'd you stash the diamonds? You're done for. Where'd you stash them?
29 Southeast.
Yeah, because his, crew didn't seem to know anything additionally.
Honestly, it's hard to believe if his crew knew for this long that they would have kept peace with diamonds when they're all living pretty rough existences. Hey, there's diamonds somewhere.
Yeah.
So I almost wonder, they might have known he had them, but if they didn't know where, they wouldn't have been able to do anything with the information anyway.
Well, the only one who could have made the move is the second guy.
Aiken?
Yeah. Because the other guy's in jail. The only thing about Aiken is he didn't really fit the profile, I guess.
Well, maybe the body will tell us something.
Small. Here it is. Dr. Yates pulls the file.
small. Here it is. That also is what she said.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry.
Oh, there it is. Dr. Yates pulls the file from the cabinet and glances through it. Ah, yes. I remember this case. Small was run over by a delivery wagon. He sustained a broken neck and was dead on arrival. That's about it. So there was nothing suspicious in Small's death? Suspicions? Not about his broken neck. It was broken. But the next day, the strange little man came in claiming that Small's wife was responsible for her husband's death.
Oh.
I didn't pay much attention to him. Death does strange things to the living. Then I talked to Mrs. Small's. Her husband's death didn't seem to affect her, but it had a powerful effect upon me. What do you mean? It is standard procedure to have the next of kin identify the remains of the deceased. It's the procedure we followed in Small's case. After showing Small's remains to his wife, I sat down with her to fill out the standard forms. I don't know what it was that aroused my suspicion. Many things, I guess. The first thing she asked me was, do you know what caused his death? Not what caused his death. Do you know what caused his
death? Man?
Yeah, he said, she asked, do you know what caused his death instead of what caused his death? I don't know why that's an important distinction.
Ah, well, Wigan says I don't understand. Maybe he, last time we did this, we tried to translate French for 15 minutes.
I don't understand, said Wiggins. As I said before, death affects the living in strange ways, and you get used to that, but you also get a feeling for it. When I first sat down with Mrs. Small, she seemed nervous and ill at ease. All very normal under the circumstances, but when I told Mrs. Small that her husband's death was caused by a broken neck, she seemed relieved, almost lighthearted. She asked me to make the arrangements for the burial. That's the last I ever saw of her. She never picked up his belongings. They were sent over to our storerooms on Westminster. Something in the back of my mind made me uncomfortable. Possible chronic arsenical poisoning. Wait, what? Possible? Yes, possible. Slow poisoning is hard to prove, but I found gastrointestinal symptoms as well as skin rashes. I then tested the liver and found traces of arsenic, all consistent with being slowly poisoned.
Hmm.
Did you inform the police? No, his death wasn't caused by arsenic, but by a broken neck. I have no idea how he was being contaminated. It could have been through his work, through medication, any number of ways. Mrs. Small may have been indifferent to her husband's death, but that's not hard evidence of murder. Well, I don't think I can tell you anything more, and I must get back to work. Good day.
Bonus question.
Maybe.
Westminster? Yeah, what is Westminster?
Well, there's Westminster Bridge Road down here. It turns out there's a lunatic asylum right here.
Yes, there is.
Let's go there.
I've always wanted to go
there. All right, let's go.
I almost wonder if she was slowly poisoning him, and then he got ran over by coincidence.
Yeah. That's why she asked.
I think you might be right. I think you might be absolutely correct.
Yeah. I didn't find it, thank goodness.
Yeah. My goodness.
Yeah.
Okay,
so
yeah.
So what do you want to get?
What if she's been the one... No, she would. She had them. She would have just broken them open.
Yeah, she had all things.
Yeah,
she wouldn't have sold them.
Yeah, she didn't know.
She just didn't like him.
I don't like him.
A solid contribution to part two, I'm sure, but it doesn't answer our main problem.
I see storerooms.
Storage facilities. Nope.
Yeah, what do we get? Yeah.
Warehouses. No.
I almost feel like that seems like that terminates there.
No, they gave us the lead of for his belongings.
Oh, I guess you're right.
Check the index, like the directory. The name part, I guess. Mm.
But what did they call it?
Westminster.
They just said on Westminster, I think.
Oh, on Westminster?
Yeah.
Mm.
There's a Westminster Abbey and a Westminster Chapel.
Are they in Southeast?
I have to assume so, because St. Thomas is right there,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, so St. Thomas is there.
Oh, if that's the hospital, maybe the storeroom is at 50?
Maybe.
Very likely, anyway.
Oh.
We'll just go down the road like we did that one time.
Yeah, that turned out.
Go to 50.
50 southeast. Nope.
Alright. Oh, we still have Porky Shinwell and Quentin Hogue if we want.
Well, there are a couple more locations we could try. You could try 30, 31, and 51.
Mm-hmm.
We're right here.
We're more likely to hit something accidentally.
There's...
Yes.
There's a 31.
Is it the warehouse?
And it says, St. Thomas Hospital storage rooms are across the street.
God!
51?
I love whoever made this game.
I looked for it.
Wait.
51 was the one across the street, right? 31 was the... It's across the street?
There's many streets. It's...
Oh, no. Across the street from 51.
But 51's not there.
52?
There's no 50.
Is there 52?
No.
How about 51?
No.
What about 46?
Nope.
What about 33?
Nope. It's 32.
32 is kind of across the street.
This is silly.
It is. Especially if it's across the street on Westminster, it feels like it should be 51.
Yeah.
It really does.
52, maybe.
Oh, well.
Maybe the storeroom is just not important. They shouldn't have mentioned it. It wasn't important.
No, no, this absolutely can't be. There's got to be something in here.
Could be a rattle machine.
I just looked up the answer.
Wait, where were we? 31?
Yeah.
Oh, there's a 30.
Oh.
We're the best detectives in the world.
Small, Jonathan. Personal effects. This must be what you're looking for. The clerk sets the box down in front of us. Will you be taking them with you? No, we just want to examine them. Sure would like to get rid of some of this junk. Don't know why we have to keep it around. We find the following items among Small's personal effects. 1. 1 suit of men's clothing with the label Roberts and Parfit. 2. An old Roman coin. 3. A letter which reads as follows. Johnny, I understand your problem. Try to hold on them. If you can't, try to sell them to him. I trust you to do what's best. Luck, Nat.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Are there prisons in the directory?
I don't think they keep such delinquents in London proper.
Yeah.
I also feel like we just want to know the identity of that man.
Picture also.
The guy who killed him. If we had that, I'd be fairly happy with life.
I don't know if there's any significance of the Roman coin.
Man, it sure looks important, though.
Took the time to draw it.
Unless the coin was maybe from the bank robbery in some way, but mm-hmm. The bank wouldn't have been an old coin, probably.
Yeah, right now.
Commodus. That's the son of Marcus Aurelius. Dressed up like Hercules and fought guys in the gladiatorial arena. Usually had him like poisoned and weakened beforehand so you could beat him real easily. Was eventually drowned by his own slave in the bathtub.
Do we know who he was trying to sell them to?
No, it just says him.
Yeah, but I'm just, I guess, based on the info we have.
Moriarty.
Sherlock Holmes.
I'm just a little quirky and a little toad. Can I help you?
Paul's excited about my cortisone-filled socks.
He does love those.
Snipping
my feet.
Yeah, I'm feeling quirky.
August Girl points out that the clerk wishes he could get rid of some of the junk in the dead man's trunk.
Well, quirky, code. Gonna be pretty frowny if we can't figure out the actual name of the guy who killed him. It's a pretty big gap in our investigation.
I can't think of what else to chase around Small himself, so yeah, maybe Porky is a good destination.
Right, that is 52 EC.
52 EC.
Maybe there's someone, I'm hoping there's someone in Small's crew that simply wasn't known to the bartender at, or...
Well, so...
I mean, it's either that or we, yeah, it just is.
Maybe Drummond's knows about the bank robbery.
I was gonna say, that might be worth following. What was our entry?
Ours is 52 EC.
52 EC.
What if it's, who's the fence from the past case? Because he did try, he was convicted of selling stolen goods. So maybe he tried to sell what he had if he couldn't hold on. Oh, keep going. give me your reading.
Wiggins, my boy, how are you? You look a mile thirsty. Fine, Porky, thanks. But a fellow named Oswald Mason isn't doing quite so well. He was murdered last night. Have you heard anything about it? Mason? No, can't say I've heard even a whisper of the affair. Watson was in earlier asking the same question. Must not have involved any of the chaps that hang around here.
Well, Hogue will be more reliable, but that's definitely criminal affairs.
Hogue?
Hogue, yeah.
Where's that at?
35 EC.
35 EC. Good lord! I get some windfalls this game. We find Quentin Hogue busily at work. His desk is covered with paper, folders, and newspapers. His head is resting on his left hand. His right is beating out a steady cadence with the pencil it holds. He doesn't notice us standing at the door until Wiggins calls his name. Hogg's eyes, which have been fixed on the papers in front of him, now focus on us. Ah, Wiggins. Come in if you can find space. Thanks. We all make our way into the cluttered office. Hogg pushes the chair away from his desk and leans back in his chair, replacing his pencil with a cigarette. Keeping it busy, Quinn? Asks Wiggins. To be sure. But it is because of Holmes that I'm in this mess. With a sweep of his hand over the cluttered desk, he lets us know that this is the mess of which he speaks. You know, Wiggins, how Holmes is always ranting and raving about Moriarty, and how his organization covers the city of London like a spider's web. Well, to be perfectly honest with you, I didn't take it very seriously, but now I'm convinced he is right. I've been going over a number of cases, and a pattern is discernible in many of these crimes. What I'm finding is that it extends into the justice system itself, with some very well-known solicitors, barristers, and maybe even a judge or two on the payroll of Moriarty. My God, I'm starting to sound like Holmes. I cannot trace anything on Moriarty, but I'm starting to believe in him. I'm sure that Holmes will be interested in anything you uncover. Do you plan to do an article on Moriarty? That's the frightening thing. I can't find any evidence that leads to Moriarty. If I said otherwise, I would end up in court for slander. I might be the one that ends up in Milbank. Who got you started on this? Remember the murder a couple of years ago of the hansom driver? The one with the bag of Roman coins around his neck? Well, Holmes is still working on that one. We've had some talks about it. I couldn't understand why he was so interested in it. I sort of put it out of my mind. Then I started to notice these Roman coins appearing on the bodies of murder victims every now and then. Knowing how much Holmes likes these little problems, I mentioned it to him. Of course, he already knew about it, and he felt they were being used by Moriarty as a sign whenever he murdered someone who crossed his organization. It's like a jigsaw puzzle, Wiggins. I have a lot of the pieces, and some of them are going together, but I can't tell what the final picture will look like. Maybe Holmes can put some of the pieces together for you. You know Holmes. He likes to keep us lesser lortles sweat a little. He gives me enough to help keep me going, enough information to keep me on the track, hoping that we'll turn up one little piece of information that he doesn't have, which will clear up the mystery. Well, that's what the game is about for him, anyway. Speaking of mysteries, what are you working on? The murder of Oswald Mason. Oh, yes, I read about that in the Times. Anything of interest there? I was hoping you could tell us. Sorry, I don't know anything about it. Let me know if there's anything I should look into. Will do. Thanks, Quinn. Hey, Wiggins, shouts Hogg as we are leaving. Any Roman coins found on the body? Not that I know of. Damn, don't know if that makes me happy or not.
Huh. Well, we just solved one murder.
Well. While you were talking to Hogue, one of the...
Is this about cows?
No.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
From the March 12th, 1888 newspaper.
How long ago was that?
Two years. 1 month.
DeVries diamonds never found. This month marks the first anniversary of the daring DeVries diamond theft. Scotland Yard is apparently no closer to discovering the whereabouts of the stolen gems now than they were a year ago. Nat Cook, who was convicted of the crime and is now serving a sentence in Millbank Prison, persists in his claim of innocence.
We've read this one. I forgot about that.
The manager of DeVries testified that two men committed the robbery and two men were tried, but only Cook was convicted. Jonathan Small, his co-defendant, was acquitted. The reward for the recovery of the diamonds continues to be offered, but thus far no one has stepped forward to claim the prize. So we definitely, I think, can safely say the diamonds were probably what was in the statuette.
Most certainly.
And with Moriarty's connection into this, we now have a reason to talk to the Moriarty guy.
Yes.
So did Moriarty kill Small since the Roman coin was in his pocket?
I think one of his men or him, certainly.
Yeah, and also, like, Moriarty seems, like, very capable of having an unmarked carriage run a guy over.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I'm not sure why, though, but maybe this will tell us why.
Yes,
so
indeed.
That would be
to the toy factory.
18 Northwest.
18 in the Northwest.
Or we get a ridiculous clue that we'll have to spend an hour trying to figure out what it actually
There's
is.
There's a check in the box made of gold.
18 Northwest? Oh, wait, I'm in the Southwest.
Yes, it is.
Oh, this is very small. We asked Sam Parsons if there are any messages for us. All it was, he says, you know who came in yesterday, looked around for a while, and then left without leaving a message? He was acting nervous. I think he was being followed, so nothing today.
Who?
The guy who usually leaves us coded messages about Moriarty kind of came in yesterday and decided, nah, I'm not leaving anything today. I'm just, no. But
so,
the meta game is afoot.
Oof.
Well,
was Hawkins one of Moriarty's guys?
I think that... I don't think that we can conclude that necessarily. I think that...
All we can conclude is that Small was on his bad side. Perhaps for not selling him the diamonds.
Mm. Yeah, something weird about that.
That would put... Yeah, that would make sense for
who
him is.
Yeah, but at the same time,
Well, that would explain Nat's note.
Yeah.
He says, Moriarty says, I know you have these diamonds. Please sell them to me. Mm-hmm. And Jonathan Small is like, no, I'm out of the business. I don't want to have anything to do with this. Writes his buddy Nat saying, what should I do? Nat says, I understand. Hang on if you can, but if you have to, go ahead and sell them.
Mm-hmm.
Just, you know, just to make him happy. Jonathan, before he can make a decision, is killed. Maybe by Moriarty, maybe by Fluke.
The coin seems to indicate that he
he was murdered, yes. So then...
But then they didn't know where the diamonds were.
But someone did.
Someone did.
Someone had to have figured it out. So we're still circling around this problem of who is it that knew that the diamonds were in the statues?
Can it not be Aiken? So we know with any certainty, because he's the one that logic would point to. He's the third
of those two.
And also,
I feel like I think Ned was acting more suspect, the one that was like angry and trying to turn us away. Then again, following your rule of taking things at face value, maybe he was really just irritated and not inclined to speak with us.
I have forgotten who Ned was.
Yeah,
can we see that story?
Sure.
Or that
Ned was the guy in the bar. I thought he was actually fairly friendly.
Are you talking about Leroy Aiken, who was his
third? Aiken was the one who was pretty grumpy.
I'm sorry, I had them switch.
Where was he at?
Ned was the guy at the bar, that's correct, who was just a barfly that he happened to speak with.
Aiken is 20 Southeast. Okay. Is that what you were looking for?
That was the third of the Three Musketeers,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
If it gives a description of what he looks like, that would be helpful.
He's a small man with the muscular build of a laborer, so he could have been the fight man.
Could have been.
But it was a young man that met the young lady.
I don't know his age.
Was the man also small, Hawkins?
The Hawkins guy was, well...
I don't remember how Hawkins was described.
Yeah.
Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm good.
We heard about Hawkins the first place we went to look for the statues, right?
I think so, yeah.
Was that at,
at the...
Evanson?
The factory?
Yeah, at the... No, at the Aggie Small. Gift store.
Gift store, okay, good.
I thought that was...
What was the gift store? Can you...
Evanson & Co.?
Yes.
22 Northwest.
Put it together here.
I would say I'd be interested
in... just another Gentleman Wednesday. So maybe it was actually the other store that had the mention of Mr. Hawkins.
Let me
double check.
We checked up. Was it the museum or J. Small & Co.?
J. Small & Company must have been it.
Yeah,
32 Southeast.
I think Aggie Small talked about.
Edward Hall actually gave some information on trials and legal affairs. I wonder if anything came out in the trial or about who they were associated with beyond just the two of them.
I feel like these guys have been around for a while and they've been doing, you know, their activities for a while. As we've seen, they've got a history. I think we're looking for someone that's younger who knows that the diamonds are there.
Hmm.
Yeah, because... Yeah, I don't think Hawkins could be Aiken because she would have known him.
Yeah, she would have...
She would have recognized him as part of the hunting crew and not said that he was a nice gentleman. I mean, I almost have some reason to think he had a disguise.
Right, so
I was going to ask if you could read the part about Hawkins and that.
Yes.
Again.
I must say there certainly has been a lot of interest in those statues. Could you fill us in? Wednesday, a nice gentleman. He said his name was Mr. Hawkins and that he had a shop in Southampton. Came to the shop. Southampton? He was so taken by them that he wanted to buy all I had. Unfortunately, I only had... line 5, I assume?
Right, yeah.
Left in stock, all of which he purchased. He was so impressed by them that he wanted to know where he could find the rest of them and buy them back. I was told him that there's plenty to make more, but blah blah blah, and he got the names of the buyers. There were only two. So that doesn't sound like our man, and also I think she would have potentially known him. There's nothing that absolutely confirms that it wasn't him, but it certainly doesn't sound like him.
Does Southampton give us any...
I don't think so. Southampton's a separate city.
Okay. Yeah.
All the people we could ask about the criminal element have been exhausted, and we still don't have any idea who this guy is.
There's a link in the chain somewhere.
Yeah.
And then no Hawkins is actually looked up.
But it was one and he was
unrelated. Confused.
The only thing I can think of is that, what is it, Aiken?
That's the guy that we talked to.
And Hawkins are not as dissimilar.
They're not, but I'm with what you said earlier. Yeah. There's no way she would have been fooled by him, probably. There's no reason to think he's a master of disguise.
Well, right. So he's linked to the actress girl, right?
That's exactly what I was going to say. Yeah. That's pretty much the only real connection that we have. Maybe we need to chase that a little bit more.
Her stand-in might know something about her.
Yes.
Know who she hangs out with.
Yes.
Sandra, excellent. Sandra, what's her name? She's in there somewhere.
There must be something.
What was the name of the theater?
We haven't read yet.
not Olympia.
The Olympia?
No, it was the music hall.
Wasn't that the one we kind of tried?
It was the Oxford Music Hall.
Yeah, that sounds right.
There's a music hall section.
Yeah, music hall is 13 Northwest. We went there.
13 Northwest.
Yeah.
Sandra Gamble is the word we're looking for.
Yeah, we'll look for Gamble. Let's see. Sandra Gamble makes her residence at 8 Southeast.
Hey, you're welcome.
I feel like I've read a lot of these, but it's a lot.
We all have.
We all have. It's been one of those deeper ones.
Okay, here we go. I mean, it's not a whole lot, but it's something. I can only spare you a few minutes, then I have to get to rehearsal. Sandra Gamble brushes the blonde locks covering her eyes and adjusts her robe before letting us enter her room. What can I do you for? What can you tell us about Violet Blue? Well, I've known her for about 2 years, ever since I arrived in London. We were roommates. That's how we met. She was looking for someone to spare her lodgings.
Share.
Well, it says spare.
She's drunk.
It was a rough time for her. Her fiancé had just been arrested and she was taking it very hard.
2 years ago.
Then she started to get some good parts and her career took off. She'd always been good to me, helping me get parts when she could. She got me the part as her understudy in this review. This has been a big break for me. Oh, I hope Miss Blue is not too ill. Ill? Oh no. Her fiancé got out of prison 2 days ago and she wanted to spend some few days with him.
Yeah.
Oh dear, I shouldn't have said that.
She's so drunk.
So just to confirm, when was her fiancé?
2 days ago.
When was he put in prison?
About
2 years ago. So,
Matt Cook is the man.
Oh my goodness.
We found it.
We did. Yes. We totally did.
I shouldn't have said that. She told the manager that she was ill. You won't repeat that, will you? Oh no, your confidence is safe with us. So you wouldn't happen to know the name of Miss Blue's fiancé? Yes, his name is Harold. Errol Hawk.
Hawkins. Errol Hawk, though.
Most aliases are only a step away from the truth.
Cook. It's Errol Hawkins. We've found the name.
Yes.
That's interesting lineup, though. Imprisoned on the scene.
So he hasn't...
That's probably how he knew about the diamonds.
He probably talked to Cook in prison.
Cook was in for a major heist. He was probably never going to get out.
Absolutely.
And of course he's going to boast about his
Absolutely. I think we've cracked it, boys.
Cracked. Yeah. Crack it
now. Time saved. Do we want to go visit Hawk?
He's been in jail for 2 years.
I think we know where Hawk is.
Yeah, he's in jail right now.
But I just want to see if he's in the book, just out of curiosity.
Go to his house and find some.
It's just a prison.
He's just there, hey.
I mean, Cook wasn't in the book, so.
Yeah, there's not a Hawk.
Yeah.
Okay.
Shall we make with the solving?
I think we should.
Bonus two. Yeah. We have a lot of
going on.
Oh my goodness.
All right, let's have it.
Part one. Who killed Oswald Mason?
Errol Hawk.
Pro skater.
Yeah.
didn't say yet.
Number two. Why?
Diamonds in a statue.
He wanted
in
the soles of your shoes. Statue and.
Statue.
A struggle ensued.
A struggle ensued when he was robbing him for the statue.
Property struggle, yeah. Okay.
Number three. What did the Venus de Milo reproductions contain?
Diamonds. A lot. We learned so much.
Stolen.
And specifically, they were the different.
Right. Yeah.
I
gave us
that. What is it?
He's face booking.
Go for it.
Number four. Who stole the five sisters?
So the statue. That would
be the five statues.
I don't know.
I think that means the other statuettes.
From Evanson? Whoever broke in, right?
Is that, or that, maybe Vile?
Oh, wait.
Shall we review an entry to see if we can discern what they're talking about?
Yeah, what was the break in?
Nothing was stolen.
Nothing was stolen? Okay.
No, nothing was stolen. The safe was disturbed.
They say nothing
was stolen. No, they also said nothing was stolen. Yeah, it's... fine.
Have we ever heard the term five sisters?
I assume they mean five other statues.
We haven't heard five sisters.
Maybe that's the new name of the lions.
Isn't the statue's name the man with the broken nose?
No. We're talking about other Venus de Milo statues.
No, we don't know what we're talking about.
Yeah,
that's me
five
assuming.
Sisters. Wait, what does the question say?
Who stole the five sisters?
Who stole the five sisters?
Is that something that we learned when we were reviewing?
I've never heard the term five sisters tonight.
No, I definitely haven't.
No.
What's the Evanson and Company entry again?
Evanson is 22 Northwest.
August Gold points out, someone stole five sisters. I think that's called kidnapping. What? Say it again, I'm sorry.
22 Northwest.
Oh, 20? Is that the name of the diamonds?
Maybe.
That would be in the first newspaper. Unless, of course, we're supposed to go to DeVries and find out that's what they were called.
At Drummond's? That has to be it, right? Wait. Yeah, there's nothing about the five...
Johnny
here.
Small, the known.
I think
actually the safest assumption is that that's the name of the diamonds.
Yeah,
maybe
we could have found that out by going to DeVries.
Actually, okay, that makes a lot more sense because I was starting to suspect that maybe the diamonds were in multiple statues, which is why they keep looking for them, because they're scattered throughout multiples. But they're not in all of them because they broke some and then left two intact.
And left two.
They broke enough to find all five and then stopped. I think we have to conclude that Five Sisters is the name of the diamond set that was stolen.
That actually makes sense for another reason too, because why would you put them all in one statue if you've got 15 of them? You know, hedge your bets a little bit.
Exactly.
Losing one is no longer catastrophic.
In which case, I think the answer to number four, as Fieldy said, is...
Johnny Small.
And Nat Cook.
Yeah. Although oddly, only Cook was convicted. Do we want to make anything of that?
Matt Cook insists that he didn't
do it.
And
Johnny Small had them, so.
True. Okay, Cook and Small. Alright.
Who, this is number 5.
Oh, okay.
Who is the murderer's accomplice? Violet Blue, right?
His wife.
Violet Blue.
Part 2.
Okay.
Number 1. Who's responsible for the shortage of funds at Bacon & Company?
They were, right? They're embezzling, right?
The name of Bacon & Company.
Yeah, Bacon & Company.
The name of which we learned from one Mike.
Right?
It was Mycroft that told us when we accidentally.
Essex.
Yeah, we accidentally walked into Mycroft.
Essex and York.
Michael Essex and Mitchell York. Okay.
Very well.
Essex and York. Indeed. Got it. Next.
Number 2. What is the distinctive sign of murders ordered by Moriarty?
Broken neck.
missing moon. Number 3. What was found in the body of Jonathan Small?
Arsenic.
Oh, yeah.
Oh.
Arsenic. Nice. Next up.
Please, that's the end of the questions, but then it says, please read Chapter 37 Southeast, Waterloo Station, before proceeding to the solution.
Oh, okay.
Which we've already been to, and then went and goofed around.
At least we know they're going to give us that one now.
Yes, indeed. That makes a lot of sense. Everyone ready?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes.
Well, finally. Here are our friends now, Lestrade, says Holmes, as he and Inspector Lestrade of Scotland Yard stand flanking Errol Hawk and Violet Blue, just in front of the barrier at Waterloo Station. It was a pretty problem, as my instincts told me this morning. Hawk here, for all his personal fastidiousness, was a most untidy thief and a brutal murderer. Errol Hawk succumbed to the lure of the DeVries diamonds from the first moment that his cellmate at the Millbank prison, Nat Cook, told him of their whereabouts. Desperate that the death of Jonathan Small, his partner in the 1887 diamond theft, would lead to the dispersal or destruction of the Venus statues, Cook found himself forced to take on a new partner. Just 9 days after Small's death, Hawk was released from prison, where he had been serving 2 years for the burglary of a lady's jewelry box. He made straight for the home of Miss Violet Blue. Having reassured himself of her devotion, he set about laying his plans. Next day, he went to J. Small & Company to claim the prize, only to find that but 5 of the original 15 statues remained. He purchased them and, posing as a Southampton dealer in objects d'art, he learned from Mrs. Small where the other statues had been sold as a precaution lest the bundles he now carried did not contain the treasure. He took them to Violet's rooms, where together they broke them into pieces in vain. Errol then plunged into devising a scheme to track down the others. The next morning, continues Holmes, drawing on his disreputable Blackbriar, Hawk went to Evanson & Company, gift shop, where he purchased the 3 Venuses still in stock, and learned that the other 2 had been sold. Unable to convince the manager of the shop to reveal the names of the purchasers, he resolved to get the information by reverting to his old trade of burglary. He entered the shop that night and took down the names and addresses of Mr. Oswald, Mrs. Oswald Mason, and Mrs. Mabel Brown from the shop's shipping register. Having spent the entire day plotting his actions, Hawk arrived at the Mason home in a state of considerable agitation. He entered through the upstairs bedroom window into a house he thought deserted until he saw the light in the study. He approached the door in much the same way Mrs. Mason did upon her return. He saw Oswald Mason with his back to the door and the counterfeit Venus on the table in the far corner only a few stops away. At this point, Mr. Mason became aware of Hawk's presence, and a fight ensued that ended in Mason's death. After Hawk made sure that Mason was not going to give him any more trouble, he went to the corner table, grabbed the Venus, and smashed it upon the floor. As he was sifting through the rubble of the broken statue, he heard the sound of the front door latch opening. Seeing that the diamonds were not in Mason's Venus, he saw no reason to prolong his stay. He opened the window, threw open the shutters, and slipped out, making his escape somewhat more noisily than he was comfortable. Inspector Lestrade beams when Holmes adds, "It thus would appear that Scotland Yard was correct in its conclusion that its killer had been surprised by Mrs. Mason's return." Lestrade mumbles something to himself, however, as Holmes continues, "Unfortunately, they missed the obvious fact that it was only the Venus for which the burglar had come." With one murder done that evening, Hawk was not ready to let anything stand in his way of success and had made for Mrs. Mabel Brown's house. He climbed the roof, and in the pattern of entry which made him such a spectacular menace to the fortunes of wealthy matrons before his arrest, he gained access through a second-story window. Mercifully, he found no one at home, and descending the stairs, he
he located Mabel Brown's facsimile of the Venus de Milo. Not wanting to be seen on the street at night carrying the thing, he smashed it there. Again, he had been foiled. One can only imagine the fury, lacking in remorse, which filled his heart at that moment. Holmes interrupts his narrative and casts a contemptuous glance at the now downcast Hawk, slumped against Lestrade beside the sobbing Miss Blue. As soon as the museum shop opened, Hawk was there and purchased the four pieces on the shelves, and also learned the ominous fact that a fifth Venus de Milo had been sold only the day before. Hardly had he arrived back at Violet Blue's flat, but they were both tearing away at the wrapping and adding the statues one by one to the pile of plaster rubble by the grate. The diamonds, as you no doubt surmised, were in the second of the four museum copies. Once in possession of the stones, the two hurriedly completed the packing of their bags, then sped for the Waterloo, and the hope of a boat train and freedom on the continent.
So close.
Indeed.
The only thing I'm still uncertain about is the five sisters.
Yeah.
We'll see. Yeah.
Indeed.
We'll see. Hit us.
Holmes solved the case by following seven leads.
Okay.
That's a lot for him.
Yeah, so which seven?
Mason Home. Okay. Bank of England. Okay. Mabel Brown. Evanston & Co. Gift Shop. J. Small & Co. Millbank Prison.
It is on the directory.
My mistake, my mistake. And Violet Blue.
Okay. And Waterloo Station, even though they didn't name it.
You know, for, it says in the score, for this case, the lead at 37 is also free. Don't count it when totaling your score. He also used the following articles from the newspaper. Deaths, 11 April 1890. Personal, Errol. In today's.
Oh.
J. Small & Company Ceramics from today's. Evanston & Company Gift Shop from today's. Mm-hmm. DeVry's Diamond Never Found from 12 March 1888.
It's a very short one. Arrow, welcome home, Violet.
Ah.
But it is spelled exactly the same distinctive way she spells it in her stage name.
There you go.
With an extra T and an E at the end.
Mm. Who killed Oswald Mason? Errol Hawk, 20 points. Why? He surprised Mason while attempting to steal the Venus statue, 20 points. What did the Venus de Milo's reproductions contain? Precious jewels stolen from the jeweler DeVries, 20 points. Who stole the five sisters? Nat Cook and Jonathan Small.
Yeah!
20 points.
Context.
Who was the murderer's accomplice? Violet Blue, 20 points.
Ooh.
Kashish right. asks, do you guys find that these cases get easier as you've done more and more? I don't think that they get easier, but I do think that we've fallen into the mode of it
yes.
better.
Yeah, we definitely have a better understanding of it. I think
of where it's coming from.
Touched on earlier is that if it says something is a thing, until that is disproven, you generally should
yes.
trust it on that thing.
I must also say that the quality of the cases is not necessarily gradually increasing. Some are definitely better than others. This was a very good one, I think.
Yes, definitely.
Anyway, part two. Who's responsible for the shortage of fungi bacon and company? It's Polo. Polo stole the million pounds.
Polo means bacon and company, of course he is.
Polo loves bacon.
He doesn't really.
What an American.
In fact, I was his accomplice, I admit.
It was, in fact, Michael Essex and Mitchell York, directors of Bacon and Company. 10 points.
Cool.
What is the distinctive sign of murders ordered by Moriarty? Moriarty. A Roman coin is found in the victims. 10 points.
Nice.
What was found in the body of Jonathan Small? Traces of arsenic, probably administered by his wife.
Ooh.
15 points.
Oh, bonus.
Do we get every question right?
Every question right. We
amazing.
What about the sisters?
We got that right.
Yeah, we got
Small
right.
stole them. So yes. we had it right.
There. Oh, okay.
Yes.
So we currently have 135 points. So you've crossed off Holmes's.
17 remain after crossing those off.
And
sorry.
We lost 7 more because that's how that works. So that will leave us at minus
50.
Out of that, we will end with 85.
Nice. Right.
Not bad.
Well, we didn't.
We hit up a lot.
Beat
of
Sherlock. But
we did
quite
good.
But for a tough one like this, I think even he would have to give us a nod of respect. Like,
can I say
we're
that?
Only 15 points behind. You know,
can you? Can you?
I showed up right after.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I, oh.
Yes, if only we'd gotten there just before, then perhaps we would have the glory.
Yeah, he is only 20 minutes ahead of us.
I
want to
check Millibank Prison before we sign
off. Ah, certainly.
I want to know how that probably would have saved us a lot of time. I suspect it would have given us arrow.
That cook glares at you behind the bars. Yes, it was me all along. I'll tell you who did it.
Errol Hawk, the maybe last that's under American hero.
Those loonies are gonna blow up the ocean.
We'll blow up the ocean!
Well, I was gonna see if they mentioned the name of the diamonds at the prison.
I bet they did.
Yeah, Millbank Prison is 23 Southwest.
Yeah, what they didn't, but they do mention his cellmate, Errol Hawk. So
okay.
You can get the name there.
Why don't you take us instead to Drummond's? Or no.
DeVry's where
DeVry's, yes.
Yeah, DeVry's is where the...
DeVry's Diamond, 34 Southwest.
Yeah, they never say it in the article, but I'd be willing to bet almost money that they probably will tell us at that place.
£1 million.
That or the legal affairs.
£1 million.
3 years after the fact, Bernard Nims, general manager of DeVry, still gets a pained expression on his face when the robbery is mentioned. I will never forget that day. It only took 15 minutes and the five sisters were gone.
Yep.
It's much, there's a lot more.
We did such a good job.
Yay.
All thanks to our disgusting eye.
Thanks, Matt Dunn.
Thanks. You sure are the Lord of Secrets.
Oh boy.
I feel like they're ramping up the Moriarty stuff.
Oh, most certainly.
Yeah,
it's especially kinda... since our contact for that's like, yeah, you know, I'm done. No, we're not playing in the toy store today.
Yeah. Well, good game, everyone.
Good game.
Good game. Thank you all so much for hanging out with us. This was a really fun one. I'm really glad that this went so well. Yeah. Good times. Join us again next week for another exciting case, and join us on Tuesday for more Dungeon and or Dragons. Mm-hmm. That'll be a fun time.
Well, now this, it's Dungeons and Dragons.
It's... Thank you. That is correct. Yes, there's only the one. Except for those other ones, you gotta watch out for the whole world. Anyway, have a good night. Thanks again.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.